secrets of the 10,000-year-old man.
Mitsubishi Shogun. Changing perceptions with documentaries on 4.
There's been a lot of talk lately about Britain.
Order! Order!
About who belongs and who doesn't. Now, science is about to reveal the truth about where we come from and who we really are.
It may be that we have to rethink some of our notions of what it is to be British.
It's a story that begins around 10,000 years ago, before Britain became an island and our first ancestors arrived.
Certainly, I think people are in for a bit of a shock.
We're following Britain's most ambitious ancient human DNA project ever.
We're not just conjuring this up out of nowhere. We really do have scientific data.
Scientists will analyze the entire DNA of Britain's oldest complete skeleton.
Maybe there's a good reason why he was lying on his own in that cave. Maybe there's something really special about him.
Shedding light on unanswered questions.
It'd be nice to find where his closest relatives are.
And the world's foremost prehistoric model makers will bring him back to life.
I would like to see the faces of the people who will see his reconstructions. You can say this is your ancestor.
Allowing us to come face to face with the first modern Brit.
One, two, three.
They're laying out the dead in London's Natural History Museum. There are a staggering 80 million specimens here. But this is among the most precious. It's the oldest complete skeleton ever found in Britain. An extraordinary 10,000 years old. It's known as Cheddar Man.
It's very unusual to find any material really from this time period. So to find a complete skeleton like Cheddar Man is actually quite amazing.
Cheddar Man was unearthed a little more than 100 years ago in Gough's Cave in Cheddar Gorge, Somerset. Workers were opening up a new show cave, big business at the time, when they dug up the complete skeleton. Nothing like it had ever been found in Britain before, and it caused a media sensation.
At the time, they had no idea how old it was. There were discussions of how primitive it might be, that it might be some very primitive human, but of course it was a modern human, and we now know that it's about 10,000 years old.
10,000 years ago marked the end of the last ice age. The glaciers that had made the UK uninhabitable had receded. Britain was connected to Europe by a huge land bridge called Doggerland. And human pioneers crossed over. The early British population was tiny, around 12,000 in the whole country. Cheddar Man's tribe was among them. Britain has been continuously occupied ever since they arrived. So we can call them the first modern Brits.
Cheddar Man was a hunter-gatherer, so he was living off the land. These would have been mobile people moving around a landscape that was climatically, you know, becoming similar to the Britain we know today. You know, woodland and trees. And they were looking for living space. They were looking for a comfortable environment in which to live. And Britain at this time was providing that.
Cheddar Man settled near the spectacular Cheddar Gorge. At 3 miles long and as much as 400 feet deep, it would have been a dramatic feature on the landscape then as now. The era was called the Mesolithic, the Middle Stone Age, a time before farming. And Cheddar Man and his tribe chose Cheddar Gorge for a reason.
So we think Cheddar Gorge would have been a good place for humans to live at that time because, first of all, there were good water supplies there. Those water supplies were also have attracted game to drink from those water supplies. You will have a slightly more sheltered environment. So this would be a good place to exploit a variety of resources.
At the bottom of the gorge, Gough's Cave remains one of Britain's most important prehistoric sites. A replica skeleton marks the spot where Cheddar Man was found. He might simply have died here, or perhaps he was brought in by members of his tribe and buried.
We don't actually know if the Cheddar people were living in those caves. I mean, obviously his body is in there, but we don't have evidence of occupation. People have speculated that people were putting their dead into these caves, so they became sort of sacred tombs, if you like, where the ancestors were, and it's possible that Cheddar Man was put into Gough's Cave in that way.
For such an important specimen, we know surprisingly little about Cheddar Man. He was small, about 5'5", weighed around 10 stone, died in his early 20s, cause unknown. He has good teeth, so he probably had a decent diet. That's pretty much it. But our knowledge of this very special individual is about to be transformed by an ambitious scientific project. A team at the Natural History Museum, genetics professor Ian Barnes, and his colleague, Dr. Selina Brace, will carry out the first ever full DNA analysis of Cheddar Man. Something that's only possible now because of spectacular breakthroughs in DNA science.
The technology for doing DNA sequencing has changed absolutely massively in the last 10 years. Until about the beginning of 2007, 2008, we were using a technology that had been around for maybe 20 years or so. Was very good, it was very efficient, and we knew what we were doing, but the amount of DNA sequence we could generate was very low. Now, I can do the work in one day that would have taken maybe 2 or 3 years to have generated.
No British individual this old has ever had their genome successfully tested, and the team hopes to solve some long-standing mysteries about our early history. What did the first Brit look like? What was his skin color? Where did his ancestors come from? And 300 generations later, how does he relate to us today?
I think that's what's fantastic here, is that chance to build up a complete picture about one famous individual, one famous person who died 10,000 years ago.
First, though, the team must take a careful look at the skeleton and work out how to extract his DNA.
We don't really know, I think, what posture he had when he was found. So whether he was laid out like this or whether he was more sort of tightly curled up or,
When you first come looking at a skeleton and trying to work out where you might want to drill into that skeleton to get some bone powder for DNA analysis, you're looking at the best type of bone that you can get. Typically, our favorite bone of choice, as it were, is the petrous bone.
It's a bit of the inner ear bone that extends into the skull, inside the skull.
Can you just sort of hold it to the side for me so I can see how that petrous is looking?
Okay, so...
Well, I want to actually get... If I'm going to drill through, I'd want to go up in there.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah. I think that looks like it's going to be accessible.
But extracting DNA from bones this old is a big challenge.
What we have to remember is that as soon as any organism dies, the DNA begins to break down and becomes more and more fragmented, and it becomes increasingly harder and harder for us to get that DNA and to pull it out and to make sense of that DNA.
The team does have one thing in their favor. A cool, dark limestone cave like Gough's Cave offers a very good chance of DNA preservation over 10 millennia.
I'd be really happy to try that. If everyone's happy, then I would be.
Okay.
Priceless skull in hand, Selena's about to enter the part of the museum the public doesn't see, where she and more than 350 other scientists carry out cutting-edge research. The museum's ancient DNA lab is one of only a handful on the planet that are capable of carrying out this work.
One of the major problems with working with ancient DNA is that of contamination from modern DNA. We have to be completely covered from head to toe. We wear special suits because we are, in fact, like a walking bit of contaminant, a walking bit of modern DNA.
The ambitious project is costly, and the team knows the stakes are high.
It's something that no one's done before. It's just going to be really exciting. I have to admit, it's also a little bit terrifying, the idea of putting a drill into such an iconic skeleton.
This is probably the one shot that we have of recovering DNA from this specimen. The pressure's on.
Mitsubishi ASX, changing perceptions with documentaries on 4.
You're here. The beach is here. Let's do this. Beach holiday your way with onthebeach.co.uk. Choose from thousands of flights and hotels. Even spread the cost until 2 weeks before you fly. Let's get you to the beach. Onthebeach.co.uk. Atoll protected.
Remember those lovely morning walks as the sun rose over the Canaries?
And those lovely afternoon cocktails as the sun rose over the Yardarm. And I'll never forget that gala night in Tenerife. I mean, you look gorgeous in that red dress.
Well, actually, it was in Madeira, and I looked gorgeous in that blue dress.
Blue? Was it? What was after Madeira?
Wales.
Wales?
No, Wales!
P&O Cruises.
This is the life.
I saw something I was not supposed to. They gave me a choice. Die or become a sparrow.
You'll be trained to determine the target's weakness and exploit that weakness to extract information.
Are we going to become friends?
They'll never let you go no matter what you give them.
I know the nature of the men I work for. I'll find a way.
This is what we taught you, isn't it?
You're right.
Red Sparrow in cinemas and IMAX March 1.
Renault Capture. Capture life. Now available with 0% APR representative from £169 per month.
Story, this is a great place to start. Premier Inn.
Get unbeatable service on built-in products at Currys PC World. The fastest delivery and installation at the UK's lowest price from any major retailer. We'll help you choose from hundreds of products from top brands, like these stylish models from Hotpoint. Master your favourite dishes with even cooking results, using multi-flow heat technology. Plus, for a limited time only, save £30 off the mark price across our full range of built-in products over £299. At Currys PC World, we help you get it right.
And here's Team GB's Eve Muirhead lining up her shot. She looks confident she can save this. And no wonder, it's Aldi Super 6. Six amazing offers on our best veg, like Little Gem lettuce, Mange 2 and chestnut mushrooms from just 45p. Now that is a saving. Get down to Aldi for this week's super cool offers.
We have your favorite magazines for only $7.99 a month. It's in your pocket. Readly. Try 2 weeks for free.
Mitsubishi ASX. Changing perceptions with documentaries on four.
At London's Natural History Museum, a top science team is attempting a full DNA analysis of Britain's oldest complete skeleton, 10,000-year-old Cheddar Man.
I'm actually feeling quite nervous because, yes, I do actually have to put a drill into Cheddar Man's skull right now. We want to make a very, very small hole, about 2 millimetres in diameter, so, like, tiny hole, so that out from that hole we'll pour this very white bone powder that we would hope would be the preserved bone of Cheddar Man himself, and then from that we will be able to pull out the DNA.
These few milligrams of bone powder could contain secrets hidden for 10,000 years. Where Cheddar Man came from, how he relates to us, and exactly what he looked like.
We really don't know before we start what the quality of the DNA is going to be like. So how much human DNA we're going to get from Cheddar Man. It could be that there is basically absolutely no human DNA left in this specimen at all.
It'll need 2 more weeks of work before they do know. Safely back from the lab, the skull now needs to be scanned before work on the reconstruction can begin.
And the inside of the skull is showing up very nicely.
A little bit more inside is eye orbits. Yeah.
This high-tech scanner was originally designed for use on the International Space Station. It's rendering Cheddar Man's skull in full three-dimensional detail.
And we're just get the bottom of the jaw.
Now, at the flick of a switch in Holland, a 3D printer will turn the data into physical reality. In a mere 19 hours.
It has a rather robust cranium. Big, so it's clearly looks like a big male. But you see his face, it's very small.
Dutch identical twins, Adri and Alphonse Kennis, are among the world's leading prehistoric model makers. And the skull they're printing is the first phase in a full reconstruction of the head of the first modern Brit.
You start with a skull, and then every skull, every individual has a surprise in store.
The brothers have created scores of reconstructions for the world's top museums.
We like to try to get a grip on this individual and to make it alive and bring his character back.
But Cheddar Man is a new challenge. A reconstruction based on DNA data.
And how more we know, how better we can make a reconstruction. How more evidence we have, sure evidence, good evidence, then that's the reliable is the reconstruction. The more reliable is the reconstruction.
It's going to be very exciting to see what the Kennis brothers come up with in terms of reconstructing the head of Cheddar Man.
For the Kennises, the first phase of the reconstruction is all about anatomy.
Yeah, 31. 31 is in the middle.
Okay. Yes, here somewhere in the middle.
Using the printed skull, they'll produce a fully fleshed out head and face.
You want to have flesh measurements on the skull. So you have a table of flesh measurements. On the table, you find the more or less exact measurements for the tissue thickness on this point, or this point, or this point, and this point. In the past, there's a lot of research done on skin thicknesses of all races, and you can then figure out how thick is your the skin here from a guy who is the same age as more or less Cheddar Man, so around 20 years old. You drill a hole, you stick a stick in this hole, in this place, and then you cut it up on, at the right size. And then we fill up the with clay. That's the forensic way of reconstructing a face.
The first Brit is beginning his resurrection. But 10,000 years ago in Cheddar Gorge, how did he and his people live? They were the last of the hunter-gatherers, before humans discovered farming or metalworking. But they were both creative and inventive. From flints, they made sharp blades called microliths, creating tools and knives for cutting. From antlers, they carved harpoons for spear fishing. And they were the first humans in Britain to create a vital new weapon, the bow and arrow. They put their inventiveness to good use, as Mesolithic expert Rick Schulting explains.
This is long before there was any hint of farming practices in Britain. So they would have been hunting things like red deer, aurochs, which are a very large form of wild cattle, wild boar, and collecting hazelnuts, berries that would be available seasonally. They probably had quite well-defined territories that they moved around seasonally. They would have known their landscape very, very intimately in terms of what was available at certain times of year, where the best places were to go for fishing. For hunting in the autumn, as people would do today when the animals are in their top condition before winter.
And they had another hunting asset at their disposal. Dogs.
The dog had been domesticated for some thousands of years already. Once you have those, you have the possibility of driving game. And quite often we know from, again, ethnographic accounts that men, women, and children would participate in game drives. And we're on the doorstep of Cheddar Gorge, which can funnel animals into a narrow place, which is a classic landscape that you would use this style of hunting with.
Nothing went to waste. They used bone and antler needles with animal gut thread to make clothing, and wood and animal skins to create flexible shelters that could be quickly moved if needed. As for Gough's cave, Rick also believes that it was a place mainly reserved for ritual.
Very unlikely that people at this time were actually living in caves. They might have been used as temporary shelters to get out of the rain, but they're also often used as burial places.
Cheddar Man may not have been the only human to have been buried in Gough's cave. Other bones have also been found there of earlier temporary visitors to Britain. They lived in the cave nearly 5,000 years before Cheddar Man. These temporary visitors came during an ice age thaw, but were driven out, like all previous humans in Britain, when temperatures dropped again. Their bones are also being analysed by the team to see if there's a connection between them and Cheddar Man. Were they his ancestors? Was the cave even a kind of ancestral tomb? If they were ancestors, there's a shock in store, because they appear to have been cannibals.
You don't want to give in and say, yes, they were cannibalized, but the evidence is so clear.
Dr. Sylvia Bello has spent the last 10 years studying the cannibal bones of Gough's cave.
So this is one of the tooth marks, a score, that we can see here. And here there are two very fine cut marks. So this is on the femur, and there are the chewing marks, the cut marks, and a percussion mark, all in the same area.
We think we can identify five individuals. There's a young child, maybe 3 years old. We've got two adolescents, teenagers, based on the jaws and teeth. And then we have...
an adult.
Have they all been treated this way?
Yes, all been treated, all been modified. There's this constant filleting and detachment of the muscle.
We've got finger bones and toe bones.
Yes, these were modified in a it just crushed the end, and it's probably crushed between the teeth
in
and
the
then
mouth.
And sucked the grease. So because of that, it's possible that they were boiling these bones, so to make it softer to extract.
And otherwise, there's no evidence of cooking, though.
There's no trace of direct fire or contact of fire with the bones. They don't seem to have been cooked, at least in that way. Mm. They were all butchered.
Yeah. I think the idea of cannibalism for many people is shocking. It seems to some people like the ultimate taboo. Yeah, I had that view too, that we should look for alternative explanations for the modification of the cheddar bones. But of course, once you see evidence of actual human chewing marks on the bones, it's very difficult to argue with that.
The team thinks that the cannibal behaviour wasn't driven by hunger, but by something else.
But here there seems to be some care all around to obtain a result, this final cup, a skull cup. And that's why they are not so broken.
These purposefully made cups, literally so you can drink out of your ancestor's skull, suggest that the cannibalism may be part of a ritual.
Was this part of a tribute to the dead, that within your own group, when one of your relatives dies, you eat parts of them in order to take on maybe their courage and knowledge? In other words, it's a sort of respect for the dead.
Through DNA analysis, the scientists hope finally to prove whether these older, temporary settlers were Cheddar Man's ancestors. But everything, how he relates to us, what he looked like, whether he is descended from cannibals, now depends on whether the team can successfully retrieve Cheddar Man's DNA. And they're about to find out, because Selena is en route to the museum's high-tech DNA sequencing lab.
When you get the sequencing data back, that's when you can be starting to think, wow, what can we tell about this individual?
These state-of-the-art £200,000 machines can crunch tens of millions of pieces of data, a process that used to take several weeks and still takes many hours. In Holland, they really need that data. The basic anatomical work is almost complete. The burning question for the Kennises now is Cheddar Man's skin color.
Maybe most people expect that he would be the same color as people living today in the area, because he lives in the same area. But he lives in all a different climate, and he came from another part of the world, and he came in quickly. I don't know what's... There are so many factors who can change his color. There's so many factors involved with color, so I don't know.
Here's the current thinking. Modern humans appeared in Africa around 200,000 years ago and were all dark-skinned. About 60,000 years ago, hardy pioneers left to populate the rest of the world. Those who went to Europe over time became lighter-skinned. They needed paler skin to absorb more sunlight to produce enough vitamin D. Most scientists have assumed that Europeans had already developed paler skin many thousands of years before Cheddar Man. And these previous reconstructions of the first Brit reflect that thinking. But without DNA evidence, it's all guesswork.
So we really don't have a great idea about what Mesolithic people would have looked like. We assume that they're probably quite similar to people that you see around today.
Many people maybe expect that it is maybe a white guy with blonde hair, a kind of Viking.
When we think about what the appearance of Cheddar Man may have been, often depicted light skin, light hair colour, light eyes. But in fact, Cheddar Man could have been quite different to that. Might have been quite dark-skinned, dark-haired.
We'll soon know, because the sequencing has finished. and 10,000-year secrets are about to be spilled.
Mitsubishi Mirage. Changing perceptions with documentaries on four.
Together forever and ever to part. Together forever we do.
See how connected you are to Europe and the world with the largest consumer global DNA database. Discover your unique ethnic mix at ancestrydna.co.uk.
Alexa, call the living room.
Calling the living room. You're locked in the garage again.
No. Yes.
Alexa, ask Roomba to start cleaning.
Okay.
Alexa,
reorder cereal.
Alexa, reorder flour.
Reordering flour, okay?
No harm in a little snack, is there? But half the sugar our kids eat comes from snacks and sugary drinks, which could lead to harmful fat building up inside and tooth decay. So what can we do to protect them? Just remember, look for 100-calorie snacks, 2 a day max.
Movie night? You could get Haagen-Dazs vanilla ice cream from Morrison's for $4.42. Or you could get deluxe Madagascan vanilla ice cream from Lidl, 2 mini deep dish pizzas, potato wedges, oh, and a bottle of cola. That's your evening sorted, all for just $3.75. Big on quality, little on price.
.com. .london. This is a London thing. It's a London thing.
Why be a .com business when you can be a .london business? Get your .london web address. Visit makeyours.london.
We've come a long, long way together. Through the hard times and the good, I have to celebrate your pain.
Yesterday, today, and tomorrow, we have been and always will be by your side.
I have to praise you like I should.
There's something unusual happening at Britain's biggest bingo site. A unique, totally free-to-play game called Stars, where a lucky few will win a share of £30,000 every week. Simply reveal your stars each day to be in with a chance of winning. Find your stars for free at Tombola.
No ifs or buts. It's easier when you can use the Link system that lets you use your favourite apps directly on the car's touchscreen. The new 500 Mirror family. From £139 per month plus initial rental.
See that meteor shower last night?
Yeah, it was up all night.
Something's going on. Something terrible.
Let me get this straight. Your old man shot some rays out of his eyes.
Not my dad, this thing. He isn't who you think he is. He's my father, but he's not my father.
Philip K. Dick's Electric Dreams returns with The Father Thing, 26th of February at 10 on Channel 4.
Mitsubishi Mirage. Changing perceptions with documentaries on 4.
At the Natural History Museum, Cheddar Man, the first Brit, may soon give up his 10,000-year secrets in the museum's high-tech DNA lab. One of the key questions the team wants to answer is, how Cheddar Man are we? 300 generations after he died, what's his genetic legacy today?
I'd love to know where his closest relatives are. Are they somewhere else in Britain, or are they across the ancient land bridge that existed in continental Europe? I think that will be one of the most interesting things to look at.
One of the really important questions is to examine his genome and see to what extent we can claim that there is continuity of settlement in Britain from Cheddar Man all the way through to the present day. We might see that there is a reasonable degree of continuity of ancestry going all the way back to Cheddar Man. So we might find that Cheddar Man is actually very similar to many people that live in Britain today.
Where better to collect modern DNA data for comparison with Cheddar Man than the village of Cheddar itself? Ancestry UK's Brad Argent has the kits.
My name is Brad.
Yes.
And you are?
Heather.
Heather. Do you have much of a connection with the village?
My ancestors I can trace back as far as 1650.
Many of my ancestors were carpenters.
My husband's traced our family to 1600.
It does suggest that our family's been in this area for quite some time.
Happily, living DNA donors don't need to have their petrous bone drilled.
I'm going to need you to spit into this test tube. It's pretty disgusting, I guess, but you know, that's science.
A tube full of saliva will do it.
That's where you need to fill it up to.
Up there?
Yes, so it's about a teaspoon.
Ancestry's lab will produce DNA data for all our Cheddar volunteers. What the team needs is Cheddar Man's DNA to compare it to. And Selena's got the results from the sequencer. After all the work, they've got it. These rows of G's, A's, C's, and T's are the unique genetic code of Cheddar Man. After 10,000 years, he's back.
The data is good, the quality is good, a lot more than we thought, so that's brilliant news. So I'm just getting it prepared here, ready to send off to UCL for some further analyses.
A team at UCL, University College London, will now turn Selena's data into real conclusions about Cheddar Man. Professor Mark Thomas leads the UCL team, with Dr. Johan Diekman doing the data crunching.
So there is coverage on a few SNPs in MC1R.
The UCL team are focusing first on what Cheddar Man looked like. What color or pigment were his hair, eyes, and skin?
I'm certainly aware that a number of people would have assumed that Cheddar Man had light skin pigmentation. Now, skin pigmentation, the same as eye and hair pigmentation and the shape of hair and so on, these are things that are determined by a number of genes, not just one gene. And we know a lot of those genes. We don't know all of them, but we know a lot of the genes that influence skin pigmentation. And so we can look at those and we can ask, right, does he have the variants that is associated with lighter or darker pigmentation? And by putting those together, using algorithms that have been developed, for example, in forensics, we can get an idea of the levels of pigmentation in the eyes, the skin, and so on.
First, eye colour. Research on modern DNA tells the team where the eye colour genes, or markers, are. By comparing those to Cheddar Man's DNA, they get their answer. Result: Cheddar Man had blue eyes.
Normally, we think of light blue eyes as being part of a kind of overall package with light skin and blonde hair that you see in general, and it's kind of a marker of European ancestry, a Northern European ancestry.
So, maybe the first Brit has the Viking look after all. Next, hair colour. Result: Cheddar Man had dark hair. Not quite such a Viking then. Finally, skin colour. Much more complex genetically, and it looks like there are surprises in store.
I looked at two markers that I associate with hypopigmentation, so with light skin, were both absent. We do not find neither of them. So that suggests the absence of a light skin phenotype.
Okay.
But most likely a dark skin phenotype.
Dark skin, especially with blue eyes, is surprising. Now Johan has to work out how dark.
I'm trying to increase the power of this prediction to get more of these informative markers by using a surrogate, by using another individual for which we have more data and which is no different to Cheddar Man. And that is what allows me to derive a stronger prediction and really establish Cheddar Man having most likely dark skin.
While Johan continues the analysis, the team send the news to the Kennis brothers, who've already started on the task of creating Cheddar Man's skin pigment.
Oh, okay.
Okay, yeah, the red blushes come through very nice.
The DNA shows that it has a dark skin color, and that's very interesting for a lot of reasons. What's our problem a little bit is that how dark is it in these English conditions? And that still we don't know yet.
Always driven by science, the Kennises take their lead from human anatomy. So when they create the skin, they do it in layers, inside a mold with paint and silicone.
So we want to do it exactly as a human skin. We do it inside out. So we start with the darkest pigmentation, and then lighter, 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 lighter. And then you see, we build up all those colors and they shine through. And that's why we have to make a lot of tests, because in the beginning it can be horrible if you want to make for the first time a dark skin. So we are still in the middle of what will we choose, which color will we choose. It's not too dark, not too light.
Be more orange.
And then
purple.
Yeah,
purple.
This has to be like this.
While the Kennises wait for more detail on skin color, Ian and Selina are starting to answer one of the other big questions that have driven the project from the beginning.
This is the most recent PCA that we've had.
Since Britain was newly inhabited when Cheddar Man arrived, where did his ancestors come from?
When we add in our Cheddar Man data, it's falling right here, right at the bottom the other Mesolithic individuals.
The data they're looking at plots other European populations who lived around the same time as Cheddar Man. By comparing his DNA to theirs, they can work out who he's closest to genetically.
So the other ones that it's really close to, Cheddar Man's very close to, is Labrana from Spain. This one here.
Is Lochbuhr, which is Luxembourg. And then this Hungarian individual as well.
So, Cheddar Man is genetically close to several other Mesolithic Europeans whose DNA has already been analysed. The surprise is just how closely related they are. They all seem to be part of what the team are calling the Western hunter-gatherers.
We're not seeing large differentiation between the population to which he belonged and the populations in, for example, Spain or Germany. I think it would be fair to say that he's more a European than he is a Brit.
The team have proved something else too. Further back in time, Cheddar Man's ancestors came from the Middle East.
They move across from the Near East, mix with standing Mesolithic populations that are moving north into Europe, and then end up in southern Britain.
Yeah, because no one's shown that from Britain before, have they? We've got samples from Europe, but so this actually shows that they actually would have come all the way across into the UK as well.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
Scientists have suspected these Middle Eastern origins for a while, but no one has ever proved it in an ancient Britain until now. It seems that Cheddar Man's ancestors moved from Africa into the Middle East. Later, some head west into Europe. And when the ice melts, some go to the limit of the known world, Britain. Later still, about 7,000 years ago, sea levels finally overwhelm Doggerland. And we become the island nation we are today. As for the biggest question, what Cheddar Man looked like, another member of the team, archaeologist Tom Booth, has brought unexpected news for Johan at UCL.
All right, buddy, how's it going?
Good to see you.
You all right?
Not knowing that Johan has even bigger news for him.
Certainly, I think people are in for a bit of a shock.
Mitsubishi L200. Changing perceptions with documentaries on 4.
Midlife crisis said sports car. Kids said MPV. I said, not my style. The boss said coupe. The dog said SUV. I said, why not both? She said this, he said that. I say, Arona. The new Seat Arona. Do your thing.
Hello, Freeview here. Last night in a restaurant, I overheard someone saying they pay a monthly TV subscription so they can record and rewind live TV. I almost choked on my poppadom. I marched right over and explained that they could do that with Freeview's 70 channels at no monthly cost with a Humax Freeview Play recorder. I've been asked not to dine there again.
Day 3, we set sail for Corsica, taking in Florence, Pisa and Rome. Bognor will just have to wait another year.
7-night fly cruise holidays from £899 per person, with £150 per cabin to spend on board. P&O Cruises.
This is the life.
Atoll protected.
Money's important. Saving for the future is important.
Buy low, sell high. What does that mean?
You should meet my money guy. I've got a better money guy.
My money guy got me into Facebook early.
Have you thought about the future? Have you thought about it at all?
You should be in commodities.
Annuities.
Bitcoin.
Bonds.
What about your retirement? Have you thought about it?
You know what you want?
Naturally brewed for over 300 years. Food loves Kickerman.
From Newcastle to Newport, winter is well and truly here. Whether it's a broken boiler or no hot water, no matter how hard the weather hits, our engineers can help. When winter does its worst, search British Gas.
Seen the sun in like forever, so you search for a beach holiday. Sunny beaches, sandy beaches, big beaches, small beaches, until you're lost, searching for surfing dogs. But then you find Home Away, and they search millions of homes to find you the perfect beach villa, where you all find your own rooms and a barbecue bigger than your kitchen at home. And you find that watching the love of your life teach the kids how to dive warms your heart even more than the sun. From villas to cottages to apartments, find homes that match you at Home Away.
Because I've coloured my hair a lot over the years, sort of looked more dry, but now I've started using Olia. It's got an amazing shine and it just feels a lot softer. My mum loves it and she's probably my harshest critic. You can't tell, thank goodness, that I've abused my hair pretty badly for a long time.
60% oil powered, no ammonia. Discover our stories at garnier.co.uk.
Be colour safe. Always do your patch test.
With 2 for £75 on selected Boots glasses, we'll help you find your perfect pair. Boots Opticians. Let's feel good.
Gary, the president-elect's life is in danger.
Our country is under attack.
The attempt on the president's life was a hoax.
Tell me what just happened.
Homeland returns. After First Brit. Mitsubishi L200. Changing perceptions with documentaries on 4.
Cheddar Man, the first Brit, is finally giving up his DNA secrets. The team now knows how and when his ancestors first came to Britain. But other big questions still remain. Chief among them, what did he look like? And what color was his skin? Team archaeologist Dr. Tom Booth has used his own DNA sequence to come up with part of the answer.
So I was just looking at my own personal DNA results because I was checking out that marker that was a marker for curly hair.
Yes.
And I looked at the same marker in my genome and it turns out that we've both got the same marker.
That's great, yeah.
That's pretty incredible, isn't it? So, yeah, my hair's going to be the model for Cheddar Man, I think, from now on.
So, slight curl.
Slight curl. Yeah, curlier than on average, I think, is the official term.
Tom's curly hair is one thing, but Johan now has an answer to a bigger question. Cheddar Man's skin colour. He'd already discovered it was dark, but needed help to know how dark. Now he's got a full analysis from a specialist in the USA.
Did you get those results back from the States?
I did. So I was just looking at them. So it turns out that Cheddar Man was probably darker than we initially expected in terms of skin pigmentation.
Flippin' heck.
And so, yeah, we have a little chart. The scale that they produce is basically probabilities for five different categories. And what we see is that it's pretty far down the spectrum. And it certainly is darker than we inferred before.
This dark to black result is both extraordinary and unexpected.
If a person with that color skin was kind of wandering around town now, you know, we would call him black, I suppose. That's incredible.
Yeah.
That's brilliant. And a lot darker you would expect for Europe as well.
Absolutely, yeah.
Nice. I think this is a nice call, this. The first thing.
The results are the final, vital piece of the puzzle for the Kennis brothers.
And suddenly you get an enormous nice surprise. You test something and it comes more alive than you think. And then, wow, there are good colors, it's beautiful. It could be very nice. It's a bit too black here, I think. It's too black and too red, too much red in it. If the whole face is like this, it would be nice, very nice.
I know.
The skin pigment news spreads quickly to other members of the team.
I assume that's going to be a big surprise to most members of the public. It was certainly quite a big surprise to me.
It may be that we have to rethink some of our notions of what it is to be British, what we expect a Briton to look like at this time.
It's a real breakthrough. What the team have discovered strongly suggests that paler skin in Britain and Europe is a far more recent phenomenon than anyone previously thought.
It really shows up that these imaginary racial categories that we have are really very modern constructions or very recent constructions that really are not applicable to the past at all.
Two weeks later, and the Natural History Museum is about to witness the unveiling of a new head. The first Brit is in town.
It's always fun to create a new head. We don't know what kind of reaction we get. Could be surprising, yeah.
After all these years of knowing Cheddar Man, which is more than 40 years in my case, it will be great to see this bringing together of artistry and anatomy and DNA.
We got the input from the scientists as much as possible. We feel that we put in everything we know. Also interesting to see the faces.
It's something that we've now seen all the way through from taking the bone sample to getting the genome, extracting information, and really unusually for us, actually getting a physical thing, a physical object that we can look at. I'm genuinely kind of excited.
If the Cheddar Man reconstruction comes back and it's the same as my hair, that's it. I think I might as well retire. There's just no point in going on anymore. I don't think I could ever top it.
So to get the science and the physical appearance and to have the two together, yeah, I'm really excited. It's going to be great.
After all the work, the time has come.
Nice that you all come here to reveal the Cheddar Man. I want to remind you, it's your data we worked on, so part of it is your work. But here, we will reveal it for you guys.
One, two,
three.
Hey.
Oh, brilliant.
Are you shocked already? Here we go.
Quite a delicate jaw and face and teeth, and that comes through, and it's a face that's really quite distinctive.
I think it looks great. Combination of the face shape and the skin colour and the eye colour, it all just kind of works together.
It's a very broad, big skull.
Really, really cool. To have done the genetics for someone or to have looked at their DNA so closely as we have done with this and then to actually see that made into flesh is, it's amazing. I guess it's the only time this will ever happen. I think the Kenesis have done a fantastic job.
This area is it's pretty broad, sigmatic. It's very broad, it's a broad face, broader than I expected. Yeah.
The light is now picking up his blue eyes. They're really showing now.
Yeah, the biggest eyes ever made.
And that combination of, you know, quite dark skin and blue eyes is something that we don't imagine is typical. But that was the real appearance of these people, something that's quite rare today. And we're not just conjuring this up out of nowhere. We really do have scientific data. I mean, this is as close as we're going to get to know what Cheddar Man really did look like.
He's alive. He's a person now. He's not just bones.
It's been a long and extraordinary road. 4 months of work for the artists, 2 years for the scientists, 10 millennia for Cheddar Man, to finally bring us face to face with the first Brit. And what about his genetic legacy today? How Cheddar Man are we? The team looked at data from scores of modern Brits, including our Cheddar volunteers, and compared it with Cheddar Man's DNA. 10,000 years is far too long ago to find direct descendants. But they did discover something surprising. Having identified Cheddar Man as part of the Western hunter-gatherer population, the team searched for that DNA in the modern Brits they analyzed, and they found it in pretty much all of them. So, 300 generations on, we're all a little bit Cheddar Man.
If we ask the question, to what extent do we have ancestry from the population to which he belonged? Then the answer, we do have a very good idea about, and it's a good proportion. It's, you know, something like 10% of our ancestry comes from that that population. We label those as Western European hunter-gatherers.
The final question the scientists posed has also been answered. Cheddar Man shares no direct ancestry with the earlier cannibals. So that's a relief then. But DNA science has truly unlocked the 10,000-year-old secrets of his identity and given a face to our ancestor, the first Brit. He marks the beginning of our national story and has left a genetic legacy that we all still carry with us today.
This is the great thing about working in this field. The historical perspective that you get just tells you that things change, things are in flux, and what may seem as cemented truth that people that feel British should have white skin through time is not at all something that is an unmutable truth. It has always changed and it will change.
Stuff coming up for you tonight here on Channel 4. Ewan McGregor is sucked into a world of espionage, money laundering and tennis. Damian Lewis is the MI6 officer trying to join the dots in the network premiere of Our Kind of Traitor. Next, though, no Brody, but Carrie is still fighting the system. It's the start of the brand new series of Homeland.
Mitsubishi plug-in hybrid. Changing perceptions with documentaries on 4.
Over more Fornax, could they have found an entirely new species of human ancestor? We'll find out in First Humans, The Cave Discovery.
What happens after you marry a total stranger?
Could we possibly have a kiss?
Will the couple sail off into the sunset?
I can't imagine being matched with somebody better suited.
Or will things fall apart?
You don't know someone till you live with them.
Married at First Sight continues Thursday at 9 on Channel 4 and catch up now on All 4.
Yes, I do know.
Muller Crunch Corner. Muller-licious. Muller, official yogurt of British Athletics.
Stop what you're doing! Give me all the money.
Sorry, love. I've got my hands full.
When it comes to the crunch, it has to be hula hoops.
Light. This is what Paris is made of. The light of avant-garde. The light of audacity. Can you imagine Paris without it? What if we followed the rules? What if we'd obeyed those who wanted to destroy this weird scaffolding? Can this light be turned off? Of course not. DS7 Crossback. Audacity drives to excellence.
Once in a blue moon, you are totally shocked at what you find. It's a bit of a puzzle as to why somebody would risk their whole life for the sake of £1,000.
What happens when the police officer investigating a crime?
There is no easy way of telling you this, but the person who's done this to you is a police officer.
Turns out to be the man who committed it.
I'm here to arrest you on suspicion of blackmail.
I should imagine for a police officer, going to prison will be hell on earth.
No comment.
Returning with the most extraordinary case yet.
I suppose now I just see him as a bent copper. That's it.
24 hours in police custody. Tomorrow at 9 on Channel 4.
A chance encounter or something more sinister? Ewan McGregor is a college professor who seems to find himself in bed with the Russian mafia. Could Damian Lewis be his saviour? The network premiere of Our Kind of Traitor at 10:15. First though, no Brody, but Carrie is still very much alive and kicking. With some very strong language and scenes of violence, it's the start of Series 7 of Homeland on Channel 4. Yeah.